Okay, so, the next part in our discussion after the static case is now a first dynamic case, and we call it the so-called electro-quasi-static case. So in this sense, the following relations have to be assumed, and I again mark these two very important scaling parameters, where you put in a characteristic velocity, we have moving bodies, we have in our speed of the electromagnetic waves, a characteristic amplitude of the electric field, characteristic amplitude of the magnetic field. And you see now that for this special case, it is fulfilled that this term is really small compared to one. Yeah? So you see, this is exactly this term, which in our case means that this equation here can be, at the end, also in the non-dimensional way, substituted by this, which means the curl of the electric field is still zero. However, as you can see here, this scaling part, which is associated exactly with this one, where we have the time derivative of the electric field, is of order one. So we have to keep the time derivative within first Maxwell's equation, or also called the corrected Ampere's law. Okay, so let's have a look now. That means we have to take into account, as written here in the first line, the full Maxwell's equation that the curl of the magnetic field intensity H is once driven by free electric charges, charge density, JF, and the time derivative of the electric field displacement. On the other hand, we have here this simplification that still we don't have to consider time-varying magnetic fields, because we have seen due to this scaling, we can neglect them, which means, and that is important, that the electric field is still an irrotational field. Yeah? So that means we can approximate the electric field, that means still an irrotational vector field, and we can describe the electric field via the scalar electric potential V. Yeah, clearly we have our Gauss law, so this is also clear here, and well, but the magnetic field still holds that we have no sources in sync, so the divergence of B is zero. Yeah, we have two constitutive equations in a simple form, we write them down. You know, for all the scaling, we also have assumed we have linear materials and just one material within our computational domain, which clearly means here in this case that D, which we have in first Maxwell's equation, can be substituted by the permittivity times the electric field intensity E, and the field intensity again via the gradient of V. And we should not forget that we have this general Ohm's law, because this electro-quasi-static case is especially a case where we take into account current densities in conductors, but also the so-called displacement current densities coming due to the time derivative of the electric field. Okay, yeah, so What we can do is we apply a divergence on our first Maxwell's equation. So what we have here, as you can see, the divergence of a curl of a vector field, which we know that this is always equal zero as standing here. And then we have the divergence on the current density, free current density we have in conductive bodies. And the time derivative, I already have interchanged time derivative with space derivative, the time derivative of the divergence of D. Yeah? And clearly we know the divergence of D. What we have here, we can clearly further more substitute via this equation here. And we also will use these two constitutive equations, and clearly, very importantly, that we have our relation that the electric field, which we know in a general case can have an irrotational part and a solenoidal part, we restrict it to the irrotational part in our case, because still the curl of E is equal to zero. Okay, so substituting these, we see that what we get out here is now the following. We have here the divergence of the conductivity, electric conductivity, gradient of V, plus the divergence of the permittivity, and then gradient of the time derivative of the electric scalar potential. So we see that this is a very interesting equation we have here. So we have a time derivative there and space derivatives. And we can also now bring in the physics, where we clearly see that what we have here are the conductive current density. So as we know from the continuity equation, divergence of J, and here the divergence again of a current density, but this is our displacement. Current density. Yeah? And we still model here a vector field which is irrotational, described by the electric field as well as the electric current density. Now, what are typical boundary conditions? And then I will give you a very interesting example from medical engineering, where we are also involved. So, a typical boundary condition, you have some very electrode, you prescribe clearly as shown here. So you have a loaded or a grounded electrode. Then we can have this homogeneous Neumann boundary condition. Yeah? But it is not only the part with the conductivity gamma, but also the part with the permittivity epsilon. And that will force that the field lines go parallel to the boundary. So a typical boundary condition we will apply at the outer computational domain. And then we have a very special boundary condition. So this is now again the total current density in normal direction. A typical boundary condition you apply physically, where you inject a current density. Actually, we know, we always say in engineering, we inject a current. Therefore, we integrate over the cross section, yeah, which is the cross section of the electrode, and we call this part here then an injected current. Okay, so we can apply a voltage difference, or a voltage, which is a potential difference, of course, between two electrodes, or we set one electrode grounded and inject a current there. It's up to our device we have. Okay, so what is really here different, you see, is the case that it is time dependent. Yeah, so it is not only a function of space, our scalar electric potential, it is also a function of time. Yeah, and a typical application in medical engineering is impedance cardiography. So that means this is a possibility to have a very fast evaluation of your aorta. Yeah, and that means if everything is okay, or perhaps you already, and that would be clearly not good if you have such a thrombus. Yeah, the thrombus is this additional part, what you have here. I'll take this one. So that is this red part here, a lightweight part here, which means you, if you are getting older, it could happen that the walls of the aorta cannot fully withstand the pressure of the blood, and then hopefully it not breaks. Yeah? But what actually then we may have here that the thrombus is growing, and that's clearly not good, because a part of the blood, yeah, here we have the aorta, here somewhere the heart, will also go into the thrombus. And clearly you can use a MRI, so a magnetoresonance imaging, but that always takes time. First you need the date. Okay, if it is you have any attack, you come to the hospital, perhaps they do it quite fast. Anyway, in this case, as you can see, we just have to put two electrodes, yeah, at the corso of your podo, and then inject the current. For example, this is the upper electrode, you inject the current, you set this electrode to ground, and you measure the voltage drop in this case. Okay, so now you want to simulate this. Here is a computational mesh, as you can see here. A special thing, what we are able, and we have done quite a lot of research on it, that we are able to discretize each subdomain by a mesh size as is needed to get high accuracy, and then have at the interface, as you can see here on this side, yeah, so-called non-conforming meshes. Yeah, so you see the nodes of the finite elements doesn't coincide, but we do this by additional terms we apply to our equation. Actually, we fulfill the transmission condition, and this is we incorporate in our equations. Now let's have a look to the parameters we have. So this is the aorta. You see here always permittivity and conductivity. So you see we have a conductivity of 0.7 Siemens per meter. If we look at the thrombus, for example, then it is just 0.3. So you see you have a really decreased conductivity. The permittivity, as you see, is not so much different. Yeah, and then the thorax, here we don't have modeled all the other organs as the lungs and so on, but for a precise model, you also would have to do it. So we just have here a homogeneous region. This is this region outside the thorax. Here you see we have a little bit higher permittivity, and the conductivity is even smaller as within the aorta. Within the aorta, we have the blood. Yeah, we know the blood has conductivity. And actually, it is even more complicated, and that's one of our research topics where Alice Köstlinger-Reinbacher is heading the team, where we need to model the blood properties towards the conductivity as a second order tensor. Yeah, so it is a function of the velocity, the blood velocity, and it is different therefore in the different direction, because the blood clearly will not only have a direction, let's say, going here up and down. You will have, due to the fact that some blood will go into the thrombus, you also will have the vortical structures, yeah, and so you will have an anisotropic, yeah, behavior of the conductivity. You have to model, because the velocity in this case will have any directions. Okay, if you look here at the results, just a plot of the electric field in volt per meter, well, you do not see so much difference, actually. Yeah, okay, if you look at the maximum amplitude, you see that has increased, the maximum amplitude you have there. But if you look here at the aorta, then it is quite similar. You have it here also in this region here. You see very similar value you also have in the thrombus. However, you know, also the current density distribution will be of great importance when you evaluate the electric impedance. So that is the main quantity we evaluate over one heart cycle, or more heart cycles, and average it. Then you see a big difference, and that is clearly, as we have seen before, due to the material parameters, that we have a very small current density in the thrombus compared to the aorta. Yeah, here is again the relation, and here you see that the maximum amplitude has decreased now in the case where you already have a thrombus, as in the case everything is healthy. Okay, and now actually what you do in practice is that you inject this current, you measure for some half cycles, you compute the impedance due to the injected current and the voltage drop you measure, and you can compare this to the impedance change over one heart cycle you have there for a healthy person. And there you have indicators, and that means that you get a very, very fast evaluation if there is perhaps a problem towards the thrombus or not. Okay. So you have seen that was now our first submodel of Maxwell's equation, where we had a time dependency, and that is so-called quasi-electrostatic case, where we model both the current densities in a structure due to conductivity and a displacement current density. And that is an application I have shown you. The human body, as you know, we have electric conductivity, but also the permittivity is not that of vacuum. So that is a nice application here in medical engineering. Okay, now let's come to the next case, which is for us in, let's say, for a lot of technical application of great interest in our case. It's the magnetostatic case, and what we see here is now quite the opposite as we had. Now, this term here is a term which is of order one, so we have to keep it. Yeah? So the value is about one, so we cannot say that we neglect this term compared to the curl of E prime. On the other hand, if you evaluate now this term here, yeah, which models us this together clearly with the time derivative of E prime, the displacement current density, then you can see that, yeah, this is really small compared to one. Okay, so again, if you have a problem at hand, you have to know the approximate characteristic value of the amplitude of the magnetic field, of the electric field, any V bar, Yeah, this velocity you have there, and clearly the speed of the electromagnetic waves. And then you can put into these inequalities and look if it is about one or it is really very small compared to one. In our case, this is the typical eddy current case. Yeah, so I also write it here. This is the eddy current case where we have time-dependent magnetic field generated by time-dependent currents in conductors in coils. And we now investigate here as a demonstrative example our problem we already have discussed displayed over a coil. Before we do it, let's come to the equations. Yeah, so we have seen that the time derivative of the electric field in the first Maxwell's equation we can neglect. That means the curl of H is just the free current densities we have there in our coils, conductors. We have clearly our Faraday's law here in differential form. And as we know that we always have a solenoidal magnetic field, divergence free, we introduce here the magnetic vector potential. And due to this fact, these are the old slides. Sorry, these are the slides. Okay. You should have different slides, hopefully, when you download from the thing, because that clearly is a mistake. Yeah. So we put this away. Since the divergence of B is equal to zero, we introduce B as the curl of A, and we clearly know the divergence of the curl is always zero. So that means this is automatically fulfilled if we describe the magnetic field by the curl of a vector potential. Yeah? And we know this is our magnetic vector potential. Yeah, we clearly have our constitutive equation between B and H via the permeability mu, and we have our Ohm's law, general Ohm's law between the current density in any conductive bodies and the electric field we have there, scaled by the electric conductivity gamma. Now, according to Helmholtz, yeah, just right here, this is, as you know, the Helmholtz decomposition, we decompose the total electric field in an irrotational one and in a solenoidal one, so in a one which can be described by scalar potential and ES as for solenoidal, so it's the vertical part. As we see, you have here a vorticity, the so-called vorticity, Wirbelstärke of the electric field generated by the time derivative of the magnetic field. So this decomposition we also do for the current density in this sense that we even can make it very general. We have here a current density which is prescribed in our conductors due to a current or voltage source. Anyway, we know the current density in this conductor, in this coil, for example. And then you see that in any conductive bodies, we get there a solenoidal electric field, which is due to the case we have in this equation here. Yeah, because it is, for example, a copper plate or aluminium plate, the conductivity is quite large. And you have a time-varying magnetic field, so eddy currents, as we call them, are induced. And these eddy currents, as you see, are modeled here by the electric conductivity times the solenoidal part of the electric field. But you can also have moving bodies. Yeah, so you have a vibrating plate, for example, due to any mechanical forces, it's vibrating with a velocity v in a magnetic field, and you see the magnetic field can be even a static field. Yeah? You have the time change now in the velocity. And as you know, we call this the motional electromotive force term. Yeah? So this EMF is the electromotive force term. Yeah? So this V in our case here is any mechanical velocity, for example, of a vibrating plate, or it could be in an electric motor cable. Okay, now what we see here clearly, if we look at our equation, what we will do is we will try to get, when we look at all these equations here, we will try to get out somehow a partial differential equation we solve with the finite element method as a function of the magnetic vector potential. Yeah? Because as you can see here, this constitutive equation can be put in here. Then we have here the curl of B over the permeability, and we will put in here and express B by the curl of A. And we will see that we will also put this equation in here. Yeah? So you have once the curl of E on the left hand side and once minus the time dependency of the curl of A. So we can combine the two curl terms in one curl when we exchange time and space derivative. That we see on this slide here. So I even have explicitly written, that is important, the curl clearly of the total electric field. Yeah? But so that you don't think I have not explicitly written it here. But here you clearly always put in the total electric field. But the irrotational part to put in, which is described by the gradient of a scalar potential, makes no sense because the curl of a gradient is here. That is why you immediately can write what remains is the curl of the solenoidal part. Yeah, and this is the time derivative of the magnetic field, now already expressed here by the curl of A. And let's also gauge the vector potential, so Eichen, that the divergence of A is equal to zero. Now, as I have told you, we will put here this on the left-hand side, so we have, as you can see here, the curl of this additive term, the solenoidal part of the electric field, and the time derivative of the magnetic vector potential. Now, clearly, we can set this term in where the curl is operating on to the gradient of any scalar potential, yeah? Because the curl of a gradient is zero. However, makes no sense because the vector potential is a pure solenoidal field, and this electric field already expressed due to this index S is a pure solenoidal field. Yeah? So we directly can write that this solenoidal part of the electric field is described by the time derivative, exactly the minus time derivative of the magnetic vector potential. Yeah, and then we have it here. What I should write also here, you know the reluctivity is 1 over permeability. You know, we get this out on the left hand side. I just go once back, as I told you, that by this constitutive equation we have then here, instead of HB over the permeability or reluctivity times B, and substitute for B the curl of A. Yeah, and then you have, as you see here, as we call it, this curl-curl operator, but don't forget that the reluctivity is in here, and this curl operator is also operating on this reluctivity. Yeah? And in standard, we always have at least terms of the reluctivity or permeability, typical interface between iron and air. On the right-hand side, we have now our three current densities. Yeah? So we have the current density, which is prescribed, yeah, in our coils. We know there this current density. For example, you have here the typically eddy current density. Let's call it. Due to the fact that the magnetic field is changes in time, and if you have any conductive body at rest, then it's clear that in this conductive body, eddy current will be induced, as we call it. Or you have your voltage loop, it is open, then the current cannot flow there, but you get the induced voltage between the terminals. Yeah, and what is, and clearly important, you need a gamma different from zero. Yeah, so the body at hand has to be electroconductive. But that also has to be the case for this part here, which we call here the motional EMF, but you can also call it the motional eddy current density. Yeah. So even if the magnetic field doesn't change in one part of a computation and the main part, you move the conductive body, again conductive body, we have here this gamma, then you also induce there a eddy current density. Yeah? And so what you actually see here at the end is that these eddy current densities are very often our enemies when you design an actuator, because due to the eddy current densities, you also generate a magnetic field, yeah, and that will be in opposite direction as being generated by the impressed current density in the coil, yeah, and that is why the dynamics of your actuator will be decreased. That is why then, for example, you don't use a massive iron core, but you use a laminated iron core, for example, within the actuator. Or typical example clearly is the transformer. We make the core of the transformer out of a lot of steel sheets with a very high permittivity, and to, in order to get the conductivity low, these steel sheets are very thin, they are about 0.3 millimeters. Okay, in addition, please don't forget this second equation here. I make it in red when you want to have here a unique vector potential. So you have to solve these two equations at once for each then clearly time step of interest. Okay. So we call this the typically eddy current case. You see all the physics of the interpretations are eddy current densities to time varying magnetic field in stationary bodies or here in moving bodies. Okay, so we have our model. This model is restricted to the eddy current case. We have neglected displacement current densities. You can have in solid bodies, but you also can have in air, clearly, because in air the permittivity is not zero, which is the typical part then of wave propagation. Yeah? But that is clearly not modeled. And what we get out now for our case, again, the same setup. We have here our coil. We have any power electronics impressing a current in the coil. Again, the coil is modeled very simply, not each individual winding, but we homogenize it, and we have a plate here in a small distance. And as you see, what we actually have, I already tell it to you here, it is a aluminium plate, so the conductivity, perhaps I write it here, the conductivity is about 10 to the power of 7 Siemens per meter, and the permeability is approximately the permeability of air. Yeah, so the relative permeability here, especially in the computation, has been set to 1. Okay, now let's look what we get out. This is for a typical time step. So we have computed here the solutions for a lot of time steps, for 5-6 periods. As you see, we have an excitation here by AC current at 1 kilohertz. Yeah, if you look here now at these flux tubes of the magnetic field, yeah, they look very similar as you would have done a static computation. Clearly, you will have a different amplitude. You can go some slides back and look for the static computation. But please look here. I display the steady state solution. And that means in the frequency domain, you have here a real part and the imaginary part. It's clear, yeah, because we have not only a resistive modeling of our setup, but also an inductive modeling, yeah, of the setup. And then you see the magnetic field is nicely concentrated inside the coil. Yeah, and then we have our typically flux lines. And the amplitude strongly goes down because they close, but the cross section you have outside the coil is quite large. Therefore, the amplitude here strongly reduces, and it seems as the plate has no influence. Anyway, if you look at the imaginary part, yeah, and that is now important, the concentration of this magnetic flux tubes is within the plate. Yeah, if you look here, yeah, if you look here, green is the plate. I have made it somehow transparent. And that shows you what? Why is this not concentrated within our exciting coil? So if you go back, I go back, you see nicely the real part is fully concentrated. Yeah? If you would not have an imaginary part, we would have no time dependency, for example. Yeah? Exactly, this time dependency make us the inductive part, and therefore the also a imaginary part. And we know also that currents and voltages for idle inductance, they have 90 degree phase shift. Yeah, that's perfect. So there has to be some action going on where we really get the 90 degree phase shift, because that's the real part and that's the imaginary part. Is there any idea how this comes up? Please also have a look, it's smaller in amplitude. Yeah? So the maximum amplitude we have here is about 2 × 10⁻⁶ Tesla, and here the maximum amplitude is 8.9×10⁻⁵ Tesla. So there is clearly some difference in the amplitude. Small amplitudes here, I just put a small current amplitude into the coils. Any idea what has happened here? So actually, it is exactly this equation from the physical point, which is the important equation. That is this equation. Yeah? A time-varying magnetic field generates an electric field, which will also show up here. Yeah, perhaps I should put this a current density. Yeah. Because we have a conductive plate, it's also a free current density. So this electric field, yeah, will generate the current density in the plate due to this relation behavior and this constitutive equation. So these are typically, as written here, eddy current density, or just eddy currents flowing within the plate. Yeah, and they also generate the magnetic field, and that's the magnetic field you can see here. Yeah, it's concentrated here. Yeah, in the plate, and then clearly also closed field lines. Otherwise, something would be wrong. Yeah, each magnetic field has to have closed field lines. And if we now do a further post-processing, let's look at the current density in the plate. Yeah, so this is the eddy current density in the plate, and very nicely, when you look at it, you see that exactly above the coil where you have the windings, you have the highest amplitude, and you see also a decay of the amplitude from the bottom to the top of the plate, if you have a very close look. However, the penetration depth is not so small, yeah, that it puts the current density on the surface of the plate. Yeah? So if you would increase the frequency, yeah, perhaps you remember. The penetration depth, we call it delta, is the square root of 1 over mu gamma frequency. Yeah. So if you would further increase, we had 1 kilohertz. Yeah. Then perhaps you would see just on the surface, as we know. So a high conductive body is a good shielding for high frequency fields. Yeah. And perhaps we have even a look at the directions of this current. You see it is clockwise, counter towards the mathematical direction. Mathematical positive direction is always counterclockwise. So it is, as you can see here, these are just from the induced eddy currents in each finite element error you see here, and they are, as you can see here, exactly have the highest values above the coil. So it is like a mirroring of the coil you have there. In the coil, we have there the load current, yeah, which we call the impressed current due to any current amplifier, and in the plate we have this eddy current. Now, we have to decide where the current now, which we apply to the coil, in which direction the current is flowing. Can we fix this when we know the direction of these eddy currents? Just a simple rule we learned already in electrodynamics. I also look at the chat, perhaps those being online have an idea. Do you think it will be in the same direction? You even, if you don't know this rule, you just look at your equation, at the partial differential equation, which is responsible why a solenoidal electric field is generated in the plate, and then due to general Ohm's law, we have the electric current density. So if we, I also go back. Yeah, here, as you know, it's this equation here. And you see how important this minus is. Yeah, that is really important. So we, you know, it's Lenz rule, as we called it also in electrodynamics. So here, the current is going in. That has to be opposite. Yeah. So the eddy currents have to be opposite, and here it's going out, has to be opposite clearly to the original current generating the primary magnetic field. Yeah? And then due to Faraday, we have eddy currents induced in the plate. They go in opposite direction to generate a magnetic field, which is now against the original magnetic field. Yeah? Again, with the right hand. Yeah? And that's good. Otherwise, we would explode. Yeah? Because the two magnetic fields would add, yeah, and it would grow and grow and so on. Yeah, so makes no sense. Yeah, it has to be opposite. Okay, so you see very nice example here for a typical eddy current problem for this type of subset of the full Maxwell's equation. So this is very important for us also in order to make bottle order reduction, to compute, for example, the resistive parts and the inductive parts in your setup, and then model your system at hand, the actuator, sensor, whatever, by a network model you can solve with SPICE, as an example. What is missing here is the capacitive effect. And the question is, can we get it in, this capacitive effect, or still in a subset of Maxwell's equation, or do we need the full Maxwell's equation? Before we go, are there any questions? I look at the chat, so in the chat I don't see any. I hope it would be good to go through the slides, perhaps in the evening, having a beer or something, and still try to get the physics, yeah, of all these nice or perhaps terrible equation. But you see, the equation tells us what's going on. Okay, so, and that is a new subset, and I guess you have not seen them before. If yes, I'm very happy. If not, it's not a problem because we discuss it. And it was Darwin who had this great idea to make an approximation of Maxwell's equation, but to get in both or all three effects, the resistive, the inductive, which we already had in the eddy current case, but now also the capacitive effect, without solving the full Maxwell's equation. Why I highlight this, the full Maxwell's equation? Full Maxwell's equation also describe waves. Yeah, perhaps I show you why this is so important. Yeah, so if you have full Maxwell, yeah, then also electromagnetic waves, which we will discuss in detail. Yeah, electromagnetic waves are modeled. And a wave, as we already know, we have discussed a transmission line, have a periodicity in time and in space. Yeah, so we have this periodicity in time. We have the period, and which we know is 1/2 the frequency, and we have the periodicity in space, which is the wavelength, lambda. And I perhaps write it here, it's the speed of the waves over the frequency. And now if you have to solve such a challenging problem, and in order to get sensible results here, you need a discretization in space and time. Yeah, you see already I speak about numerical solution, because For most cases, we don't will have the analytic solution. And then you have the following, that H, which is the space discretization, should be something like lambda over 15. Yeah, sometimes lambda over 20. Some just take lambda over 10, but you lose then more and more accuracy. And this lambda is lambda mean. Yeah, and you know lambda mean is C over F max. Yeah? So you look at your excitation and you have to take out the maximum frequency, which gives you the smallest wavelengths. Yeah, and then it perhaps really hurts you if you have such a small wavelength. Yeah. And that is the space discretization. Yeah. And if you think here on a hexahedron, yeah, this is about this H, yeah? So you have to put this to the power of 3, and then you get the volume of one finite element. And then you take your whole volume you have in your computational domain and divide by this volume, and you get approximately the number of finite elements. And that is a real problem, yeah? And on the other hand, we have a time discretization, and here we take the period, and that is for us clear. It is like the sampling we do for any signal in an analog digital converter. And it was also a sampling for the wavelengths, yeah? There we also have Nyquist, it's just in space. Yeah, and here we have about the same rule. I put here this 15, yeah? And clearly you have to look for the smallest one, yeah, or you write it 1 over 15 f max. Okay, so you see, in order don't to get artifacts, because if you don't fulfill Nyquist, you also know you get artifacts, yeah? So it's good if we perhaps have a formulation where we get also in the capacitive effect, and we don't need to model wave propagation. NFC is an NFC antenna, for example, in the near field. It's not necessary to take into account wave propagation. Yeah, it's okay if you take into account the inductive and capacitive behaviors, but not the wave propagation. Okay, so you see, this is something which would be then a real big step if we get such a formulation. And that makes it now very consistent and hopefully also very challenging in the sense, because now both terms, so this term, yeah, as well as, I just want to have the scalings in front. This term as well as this term, they are both about the same. They are smaller than one, but we keep now both terms. Yeah? And if you look at them, you get then this very simple relation between the amplitude of the electric field and the amplitude of the magnetic field by the speed of the waves. Yeah? So this is, and from here to here, you get this nice relation, yeah? And you know, in free space is, well, in a way we know it is 1 over the square root of permittivity and permeability. Okay, what else we have here then in this case is that any velocity v over the c is smaller than 1, yeah, which gives us at the end this nice relation that the characteristic length scale that is important now for you. For example, again, let's come back to the NFC application. Yeah, So you take the characteristic size of your NFC, and if this is still small compared to the wavelength lambda, yeah, and that means the near field, yeah, then everything is okay. Yeah. So you can compute this lambda, still the lambda we compute is C over frequency, yeah. So the speed of the waves over the frequency, and L bar would be a characteristic length scale of your setup at hand you are interested to investigate. Yeah, and now we will look which equations we will get. We know already equations, but we will not solve them for the primary field quantities B and E. But the important thing is we will be able to model also the capacitive effect, yeah, which is really great in this sense that we get it in. Yeah? But there will be no model for wave propagation, as we will see soon. Now, let's have a look. These are our general Maxwell's equation. These are the constitutive equation, these three constitutive equation. We automatically again substitute B by the curl of A, which means that this equation is automatically fulfilled. And perhaps we also gauge the magnetic vector potential that the divergence of A is equal to zero. Now, we again will use a Helmholtz decomposition for the electric field in an irrotational, so source sink field, being able to be described by a scalar potential, and the solenoidal part. So you see, I already write it in this sense that the irrotational part here is modeled by the minus the gradient of the scalar potential. Okay, now on the other hand, we have the second Maxwell's equation where the curl of the total electric field, yeah, which is, so they are here the same, can be reduced to the solenoidal part because the curl of the gradient of a scalar potential is always zero. And so you see at the end, we have the same as we have done in the eddy current case, yeah, that we can express this solenoidal part of the electric field by the minus the time derivative of the magnetic vector potential. So when we have, we express this, yeah, we automatically fulfill the second equation. Yeah? So you see, we still have to look with our introduced scalar and vector potential. We have to look at the first equation and the third equation. Okay, so the first equation is clear. It's the same as in the eddy current case. We explore the constitutive equation that we substitute here, H by B, and put in into B clearly the curl of A. And again, I write it here. We know that this is equal to 1 over permeability, the reluctivity nu. Okay, now on the right hand side, what we also have here is we model again any impressed current density. Then we have here this gamma E, which we have to be careful that this could be the total electric field here, a part due to the gradient of a potential, scalar potential. So it is a voltage loading of a coil, for example. And we know also our eddy currents being generated here when the coil, the conductor, whatever is at rest, can clearly also move, but then we get the additional term. We are not considering moving but currently. And we have the time derivative. Yeah? So this part here is the partial time derivative of the electric displacement. And here you see, if you now substitute the total electric field here via the constitutive equation, you first substitute D by epsilon E, and now E by the gradient of the scalar potential and the time derivative of the vector potential, we get here a term which has a second time derivative. Yeah? And as we already have seen for transmission line, waves have always second time derivative, second space derivative, and perhaps we also have first order derivatives, but these will be any damping terms. We will discuss this in detail within the electromagnetic waves then in our last chapter. And this, as you see, will be approximated to zero. So you see, we will neglect this second order term, which means in our case, you can also have the interpretation a little bit different. That means that the total electric field, which is the irrotational part plus the solenoidal part, classical Helmholtz, is minus the gradient of the scalar potential minus the time derivative of the vector potential. So you see, we cancel out this term, which means we just take into account the irrotational part of the electric field. That would be a second interpretation, which is perhaps a little bit more physical. Okay, so we have seen we get now a very extended partial differential equation for the vector potential, which also includes the electric scalar potential. And we should not forget that we also have our Gauss law, which we also have to fulfill. Yeah, I just go back here, as indicated here. This now we have written down, and we also have to write down this equation. The others are already fulfilled due to the introduction of the scalar and vector potential. Okay, and you see, you can also substitute here in this equation, you substitute not only the irrotational part of the electric field given by the gradient of scalar potential, also in this equation, the solenoidal part. Yeah? So we really just neglect in the first Maxwell's equation, we also call the correction of Ampere's law, that in the time derivative of the dielectric displacement, we just keep the scalar potential and we neglect the vector potential because it ends up in a second time derivative. Now, a big problem with this formulation is we mostly don't know the free charges on the surface or in the volumes of our structures. However, we can also look at our continuity equation, yeah, which we know is given like this. And we can substitute now, as you see, this long term here for the free electric charges here. Yeah. That's also a possibility. And if we do this, we now get the following equation. We clearly assume that for the impressed current density, the divergence is zero, yeah, which makes sense. And we get here again such an extended equation where we again have a second time derivative of the vector potential, and that we also neglect. Yeah? So you see, we try to get rid of this second time derivative of the magnetic vector potential. Okay, so at the end, we have some extended equation. Anyway, they are less as we would now solve for the primary field quantities, electric field and magnetic field E and B or E and H or D and B, whatever. So we get this set of equations with our unknowns, the scalar potential V and the vector potential A, and in addition, we even have gauged. Yeah, that is not really necessary. We will do it for the numerical stability at the end, but it's not necessary. Yeah, if you find any other trick to get a very stable discrete formulation with any numerical method, it's not necessary. Here we have a formulation where we even gauge the magnetic vector potential by setting the divergence of A equal to zero. Okay, so you see, we now have a very nice, or at least from my point of view, a set of equations for the potentials. And now you see also how important it is that we also know about Helmholtz, about vector fields, that we can describe vector fields by scalar and vector potentials. And that is a typical part. Yeah? The equations do not look easy, but anyway, we have now a set of partial differential equations for the potentials, which we have to solve. In order to get a unique solution, we need boundary condition. Typical boundary condition again would be a loaded grounded electrode, would be field parallel to the outer surface for the electric field and parallel to the outer surface for the magnetic field. Yeah? That they are typical boundary conditions. We know we need this in order to get for the magnetic field closed field lines, where B in N, we know that would be what we know. But since B is the curl of A, it's then the same on projecting this on the surface as A vector product with the normal vector being zero. And this equation we already know from electrostatics. Yeah, we also know it very similar in this case from this extension of the electroquasistatic case, where we have done this impedance analysis in medical engineering. So we have now typical boundary condition. Let's jump to a simple example, but that demonstrates exactly what we want to demonstrate. Yeah, that we can model here the capacitive effect as well as the inductive effect, which means we have here a simple coil and we have here a conductor. Yeah, this red one is air, meaning we have here a dielectric region of air, could be, but also any other value with any relative permittivity. So we have, and that is important, we have in series a capacitor with a coil, and we will prescribe a potential difference between this and this surface. Yeah? And then we should get out, and that is very interesting, we should get out there electric and magnetic fields. We will not see any wave radiation, but when we compute the current flowing here, and we have the voltage, and we compute then the voltage over the current, we should get the impedance, taking into account both effects, the capacitive as well as the inductive. Okay, first of all, just for the steady state solution, a magnetic field, which is as we would expect it is concentrated within the coil, and then we see here this closed nice fieldlands. Yeah. Since, and that we will discuss in really then in detail for the electromagnetic waves, we have that the curl of E is equal to the time dependency of the magnetic field, and the curl always projects you into the orthogonal plane. We should have an electric field outside the conductor. I just show here the fields outside the conductor, which should be exactly orthogonal. And that is what you can see here. You also see here very nicely, yeah, these fields. And it is exactly in a plane where we have plotted these flux tubes now for the electric field, which is orthogonal to the plane we have put out here. Yeah. So this is really nicely orthogonal as it should be. Not easy to understand the details of all these plots, but we know what we have neglected. We know what we have taken into account. Almost everything, as we know, just the wave propagation has been cancelled out in this very, very special submodel of Maxwell's equation. And I think the most important thing is then this simple post-processing you see here of the electric impedance. Yeah. And we also nicely see the resonance. Yeah. We have a serious resonance here because we have a capacitor with a inductor. So this here is just limited because we also have a resistive effect, yeah, which is clear. Okay. And you even see that you have here sensible results. However, this red line means there we have about the limit. Yeah. The limit in this sense, again, computed simply by this relation here. I go back. Here's the relation. We look at the characteristic length scale, compute what would be for this frequency. Yeah. And as we see, the frequency is going up and up in our impedance plot. And at some frequency, the wavelengths will be somehow in the size of our simple setup. And then we cannot neglect wave propagation. Yeah. So a factor of 10 is very often used in between. Yeah. So if the characteristic length scale L bar is about lambda over 10, then up to this value, we can more or less neglect our wave propagation. We can use Darwin's subset of Maxwell's equation. And we have here nicely then a possibility to get out from the field results inductances, capacitances, resistances, and then have perhaps a model which we make with a network and put into SPICE. Yeah? Okay, all these computations, if you're interested, you can go to this website. Those who already had any course in multiphysical simulation 1 and 2, know our software. It's called coupled field simulation CFS and OpenCFS, because you not only can download it as a binary, you also can download it as the source code and compiled by yourself. Okay. Yeah, the full set of Maxwell's equation will not be discussed here because we have our own chapter for it when we are also looking then for wave propagation. Okay, so we have seen a lot of submodels, and you will also have, which is very important for me, then, which I have not shown you here, but you will have it in the exercise by Paul, then to see why it is allowed to compute the capacitance of your setup or the inductance of your setup by a magnetostatic as well as electrostatic computation. However, this will be the inductance of a coil or the capacitance of a capacitor in this sense. But if you combine them, you, as you see here with all these fields, you need here this extended Darwin's formulation. But that will be again due to the dimensionless analysis, and there we will see why we can neglect some of our terms in Maxwell's equation and use then this subset of equation. Okay, in this case, I cannot compute the inductance itself, yeah, by a magnetostatic equation because we have a dynamic excitation. Yeah. But if you have a dynamic excitation, okay, you take full Maxwell or you take the eddy current case, but then you have no capacitive effect included. With this, we have the capacitive effect included and we can compute this interaction of the magnetic and the electric field in the near field where you still have no wave propagation. Yeah? If you have wave propagation, then clearly waves are radiated and you don't take this into account because we always have neglected this second order time derivative of the magnetic vector potential. Okay. Any questions? I think quite some things, but would be good if you try to look again to this equation and all these subsets to get a deep understanding of all the physical effects which can be modeled by this, at the first glance, simple four Maxwell's equation. Yeah? Sometimes you have seen, especially here for this Darwin model, they are perhaps even looking more complicated. Yeah? But they are more efficient when you solve them numerically. Okay. If there are no questions in this case, then